Test 1, 2. Test 1, 2.
Hey, Lamont, can you hold on real quick? Just get him right.
Go ahead.
Test. It's off. Test 1, 2. Testing 1, 2, 3. Test 1, 2, 3. Are we live? Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Somebody give the name of the Lord praise, for God is worthy to be praised. We honor him and we give him glory today. We thank the Lord, for this is the day that the Lord has made. We shall rejoice and be glad in it. For the Lord is good, his mercy is everlasting, and his truth endures to all generations. How many folks know that God is good this morning? If you know that he's good this morning, I want you to just declare so. Amen. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Those he's redeemed out of the hand of the enemy. Amen. We're going to snatch you out of the hand of the enemy today. Amen. We're going to tell you that God is good. We're going to tell you that God is awesome in all his ways, and he's able to save to the uttermost. Amen. If you're in a predicament today, hallelujah, you turn to the right place. You have stopped by the right worship. Amen. You have joined in with the right soldiers, amen, to come and put our feet on the devil's neck today, amen. We bless God for his goodness, amen. I was glad when they said unto me, let us enter into the house of the Lord, and our feet are standing within his gates, O Jerusalem, hallelujah. It's built like a city that is compact together, where the tribes go up, the tribes of the Lord, unto the testimony of Israel, to give thanks to the name of the Lord. For there are set thrones of judgment, the thrones of the house of David. And we say to you this morning, pray for the peace of Jerusalem, for they shall prosper. Hallelujah. Come on. They shall prosper that love thee. Peace be within thy walls because of thy loving kindness. Hallelujah. I will declare unto you, peace be within thy palaces. For thy name's sake, we do give God the honor and the praise and all the glory that he alone is worthy of on this precious day. Amen. So we thank you for your being here today. You've reached us today, not by happenstance, but you reached us because God had preordained that you'd be with us on today. Amen. We are Haskell Heights First Baptist Church here in Columbia, South Carolina. And this, we also know ourselves by the height. And you can reach out to us on our website at www.HaskellHeightsFBC.com. And you can find a copy of our Bible studies, our church newsletters, our church events, and our broadcasts, as well as archive broadcasts, and all the handouts, all the stuff that we're doing will be on our website, as well as a contact button that'll allow you to contact us and say, hey, we want to know something more about you, or we want you to pray with us. Amen. We have a prayer request on that website. Just visit us, amen, in these times of pandemic when we are a little bit isolated from one another. God has been gracious to keep us connected in this digital way. Amen. We also have a church app that you can download from your mobile app store at Haskell Heights First Baptist Church. Haskell, H-A-S-K-E-L-L, Heights First Baptist Church. If you download your church app, then you'll be a part of our notifications, and you can be a part of our worship services and all that's going on here at the church. You can also contact us on the mobile app, amen, under Get Connected or Contact Us. And on both of those venues, on the website or on our mobile app, you also have the opportunity to give. Give as the Lord has moved in your heart. Amen. We thank God for all those who support the ministry, and we bless God for your continual gifts so that we can uplift and build the kingdom. How many folks know that it takes finances to build a kingdom? You've never seen a structure built. You've never seen something come to pass without financial support. So we thank God for you who have diligently supported the ministry, and we encourage you, amen, to continue your support and to encourage others. This might be an opportune time for you to just pause right now as we begin in our worship service today to just reach out and invite somebody else. Text them the link that we text you this morning and let them know that we're delighted to just have you join us in worship on today. Amen. It's a good way for us to learn how to evangelize others and to spread the word of God all through the world. Amen. Our broadcasts, I happen to know our broadcasts are reaching all the way into the Caribbean. And we thank you, thank God for what means he's given us so that we can also be a part of a larger global community. Amen. We have a church in Kenya, Africa that we're reaching. Amen. Through our broadcast. And we're delighted that the word of God is going out in strong places, in every place. Amen. We want it to be a part of your experience. And so we ask you to come along and invite a friend. Amen. We bless God today for all those who were born on today. If today is your birthday, we say happy birthday to you, right? So we thank God for you, amen, and bless God for your life, because God brought you here for such a time as this so that you might be a part of this kingdom building experience. We also say happy anniversary to those who have an anniversary on today, or if you have an anniversary or a birthday between now and next week, when we believe the Lord will bless us to get back together again to worship, then we say happy birthday to you in advance, all right? And to those of you who are celebrating today, we say happy Valentine's Day, amen? It's the day that we confiscate to celebrate the love that God has shown us. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son so that whosoever should believe in him would not perish but have everlasting love. That kind of unconditional love is the love we're going to be preaching about on today. Amen. So we bless God for that and say to you, happy Valentine's Day. Amen. We're going to lift up our sister, Tangela Manuel, who is going to take the plunge and is going to move from the States, amen, over to the far states, over in Hawaii. She's going to be moving later on this month, and we want to salute her and celebrate her and just say, so glad for you to have been with us all these years, amen, to help us build in ministry here and to do the wonderful works that the Lord has assigned her hands. And as we do, we salute any member who is moving on and moving up into different venues and different places, that we will pray that she will connect herself with a body of Christ where she can continue those great works that she has been known to do here in this fellowship. Never excommunicated from the fellowship, always part of the family. Amen. And so a group of folks want to get together just to salute her, just to wave at her. She'll be here at the church on Saturday from 1 till 2. On Saturday from 1 till 2. And you can drive by and just say, wish her well in her venue. She and Alex and Angela will eventually be going on over. And along with her mom, will be in the great state of Hawaii. Amen. So God bless you. We thank God for the marriage ministry. Amen. Who we had the virtual Valentine event, amen, and that was a glorious event. We thank God for those who signed on and were part of that experience. It was just glorious, and I love anything that builds into our marriages and builds into our families. We are about healing families, saving souls, and transforming lives, amen. And so we delighted that it was not just a fellowship, but it was edification, and we are the better for it, amen. So when we have something else, we ask that you would join in, amen, and just be a part of the experience. But thank you to the marriage ministry for that wonderful event that was planned. And lastly, I want to just say to you that we also have the women's ministry is going to be hosting a virtual bake-off, amen. The virtual bake-off will be held on this coming Saturday, I believe it is. Check your website. I don't have my notes in front of me. The virtual, and I'll come back and confirm that for you later on in the service, but virtual bake-off, and if you want to sign up for it, go to our website, push the flyer, and sign up. For that. The men's ministry will also host an event, amen, for the men's ministry to edify the men on Friday evening. I believe it's 7 o'clock, is it, D? Amen. 7 p.m. We're going to have a Zoom call for the men. I believe that's the same day that the ladies are going to be doing the thing. No? Okay, so thanks. We'll come back and confirm. But the men are going to be having a Zoom call, so we're going to look for, ask you to just look forward to your information so you can sign on. Our brother, Tony Anderson, is going to be hosting us to help edify us with small business startup practices. Amen. And so we want to be a part of that so that we can not only edify our communities, but build into our homes. Amen. We want strong men to do some strong work. And we are excited about this new year, despite pandemic. We're not going to let another year just kind of shock us into silence. We're going to move forward with power. And we believe God to do great things. So we're going to ask you to go on our website. That's going to be the key. Or on your church app. And we're going to have those events loaded so that you can register and that you can be reminded of all the things that will be going on. Amen. We're getting ready to just take a time and pause right now, because when you enter into the house of God, it says enter into his gates with what? Thanksgiving. And into his courts with what? Praise. And the experience is really to enter into the Holy of Holies, where we can hear from God. And we want to hear from God, but we want to position our hearts and get our minds and our souls and our spirits ready to hear from God. Amen. And so we want you not to take a break now, but we want you to engage. Would you say it? Engage, engage, engage. That means get involved. We're not here to perform for you. Amen. That's done. That day is done. That day is over. We're not performers. We're not in an entertainment business, but we're in the business of exalting for an audience of one. We came together today just to exalt our Savior because he's worthy to be praised. And so I'm going to bring our Levitical assembly before us so that we can worship the Lord in spirit and in truth. I just want to pray for you. Amen. And so as we do that, then I'm going to yield this spot so that we can worship our King. Amen. Let us pray. Father, in the precious name of Jesus, God, we give your name praise and glory today for this day that you've made. Lord, it's a day that we've never seen before, but we know in advance, Lord God, that your mercies are abundant. They're brand new in this day, Lord. So we thank you and we praise you. We honor you today because you are our honorable King, Lord. You delivered us. You saved us. You set us free, Lord God. You freed us from the bondage of the enemy. Lord God, you heal, you save, deliver, set free, Lord God. You make whole, Lord God. You even preserve. That was your promise, and you do it every day and in every experience. So we just want to give your name thanks for just that. For who you are, we worship you today, Lord God. And so we lift up our brothers and sisters right now who are participating in this worship together with us. Lord God, lifting them up right before you that you might look right in their faces, Lord God. You know what every circumstance is. You know what every situation is right now, God. You know what everyone is dealing with. You know the abuse and the hurt, Lord God. You know the trials and tribulations, Lord God. You know where the heart has been broken. You know, Lord God, where the bond has been broken. You know, Lord God, where the tongue needs to be directed according to your word and only your word. You know what minds, Lord God, have been caught by the enemy, Lord God, and captivated. But we know that you know how to set them free right now, God. So we engage ourselves, Lord God, in this act of worship today, Lord God, lifting ourselves before you, Lord God, asking you to look in our faces with favor today, Lord God. Favor to heal, favor to deliver, favor to set free, Lord God. Favor to put back together which life has broken right now. God, we believe you right now that when we come forth from this worship place, Lord God, that we won't be the same as when we came. Lord God, that we'll be strengthened, Lord God. We'll be edified and our faith will have been renewed, Lord God, like the eagles. We'll mount up with wings like eagles. We'll run and not be weary. We'll walk, hallelujah, and not faint. Lord God. So we'll wait on you, Lord God. But wait, while we wait, we're going to worship, God. While we wait, we're going to worship, God. While we wait, we're going to worship. We love you. We praise you. And we thank you in advance for the miracle, marvelous, magnificent work that you will do in our midst. In Jesus' name, let every heart say, amen. Amen. Glory be to God.
Good morning, good morning. It's a beautiful day despite the cloudiness, amen. Can you just declare and decree that today is a great day? Today is a good day. It's a day that we set aside to give God praise, honor, and glory. And we are so grateful to do just that, amen. To take time out of our busy schedule just to say, Lord, I love you. Lord, I adore you. Lord, I give of myself to you completely, wholeheartedly. Hallelujah, because you created me. And you know every hair on my head. You know all of my mistakes. You know everything that I will do wrong, but you still cover and you still love. Amen. And how great is that love on this day we call Valentine's Day, the greatest love of all that was shown to us when he sent his son to die on the cross for our sins. Amen. And I think that it is befitting for Valentine's Day to fall on a Sunday in the climate that we are in. We're not here in these seats per se because God wants us to focus more on him and not just being in this building. So just take time out right now, whatever space you're in, as Pastor already said, either it's your living room or your bedroom, and just begin to worship God. Can we just take a moment and just say, God, you're so great. God, you're so awesome. God, I love you. God, I give you all of my praise, all of my worship, because it is what you deserve. I was created to worship, so how dare I sit in your presence with my arms folded. Can if you have the ability, just lift your hands. Hallelujah. Just begin to say hallelujah. Just begin to say, Lord, I love you. Hallelujah. God, you are worthy. You are so holy. You are so righteous. Hallelujah. Let's remove all of our cares. Hallelujah. Let's remove anything that could be hindering our relationship. Right now, this is the time we set aside for more relationship building. Amen. Hallelujah. With our first love. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. God, you're so great. You're so beautiful. Hallelujah. And your love is unconditional and all-consuming. Hallelujah. It covers a multitude of sin, no matter what we've done, no matter who we were. God, we know that we can come to you and ask for forgiveness. Hallelujah. So God, forgive us right now. Hallelujah. We bring you all of our cares, all of our issues, and we set them at your feet so that we become lighter in your presence, so that we're free to praise, so that we're free to worship. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. In this space. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You're righteous, oh God. You're so holy, oh God. Hallelujah. None like you in all the earth, oh God. Hallelujah. Your name is greater. Your name is higher than any other. Hallelujah.
Falling in love with Jesus. Ooh, falling in love with Jesus. Oh, falling in love with Jesus was the best thing I've ever done.
How many of you can say that this morning? Can we sing that together? Say, falling in love. Falling in love with Jesus. Oh, falling in love with Jesus. Oh, falling
with Jesus was the best thing I've ever done.
Can we say in his arms? Oh, in his arms I feel protected. In his arms, never disconnected. Oh, in his arms I feel protected. There's no place I'd rather be. Can we say it one more time? In his arms, in his arms, I feel protected. In his arms, never disconnected. Oh, arms, I feel protected. There's no place I'd rather be. Falling in love with Jesus. Giving you my life was the best thing I've ever, ever done. Oh, it was the best thing I've ever, ever done. Hallelujah, we worship you, Lord. We thank you for your love, Lord. We thank you for your love. Oh, 'cause falling in love with you was the best thing. Falling in love with you is the best thing. It's the best thing. Falling in love with you, oh Lord, is the best thing. Falling in love. Falling in love with you is the best thing I've ever done. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. It's such a sweet, sweet spirit when God visited us. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord, for your love and your peace. Hallelujah, and your joy. Hallelujah. This song just says, God, I'm just happy to know you because you make me happy and you make me whole. Amen. Oh. You make me happy, you make me whole. You take the pain away, I'm so in love with you. Lord, you make me happy, and you make me whole. You take the pain away, I'm so in love with you. Can we say that together? Say, you make me happy and you make me whole. You take the pain away. I'm so in love with you, Lord. Yes, you make me happy and you make me whole. You take the pain away. I'm so in love with you. And everything about you is right. It covers all my wrong. Your life saved my life. Everything about you, yeah, it is right. It covers all my wrong. Your life saved my life. With you is where I belong, Lord. Cause I gotta be where you are. Yeah. You make me happy. You make me whole. You take the pain away. I'm so in love with you. Come on, say to the Lord, you make me happy and you make me whole. You take the pain away. I'm so in love with you. You make me happy. You make me whole. You take the pain away. I'm so in love with you. Yeah, yeah. Everything about you is right. It covers all my wrong, Lord. Your life saved my life. Oh, everything about you, Lord, it is so right. Covers all my wrong. Your life saved my life. With you is where
about you is right.
Everything about you is right, Lord. Hallelujah. That's why we can say, Jesus, I love you. Because you care. I couldn't imagine if you weren't there. Jesus, I love you. Because you care. I couldn't imagine if you weren't there.
Yeah.
Jesus, I love you. Because you care. I couldn't imagine if you weren't there. Jesus, I love you. Because you care. I couldn't imagine if you weren't there. I'm in love with Jesus, and he's in love with me. I'm in love with Jesus, and he's in love with me. I'm in love with Jesus, and he's in love with me. I'm in love with Jesus, and he's in love with me. I'm in love with Jesus, and he's in love with me. I'm in love with Jesus, and he's in love with me. Oh, I'm in love with Jesus, and he's in love with me. I'm in love with Jesus, and he's in love. Jesus, I love you, I love you. Jesus, I love you, I love you. Jesus, I love you, I love you. Yeah, because you care. Jesus, I love you, I love you.
Can we say that? Jesus, I love,
love you. I love you. Love you, I love you.
Because you care. I couldn't imagine if you weren't there. Jesus, I love you. Because you care. Oh, I couldn't imagine if you weren't there. Jesus, I love you.
Hallelujah. Jesus, I love you. Jesus, I love you, because you care. Oh, Jesus, I love you, I love you. Jesus, I love you,
I love you.
Jesus, I love you. How many folks are in love with Jesus? I'm in love with Jesus, and it's not a one-way street because he's in love with me. Hallelujah. I wish there was somebody out there that would acknowledge right now that despite how other people feel about you, you might be chasing around trying to get love from someone that just never really seems to reciprocate. Hallelujah. On this day that we celebrate love, there are a lot of folks who are saying, I wish I had somebody who would love me the way I want to love them. Amen. And I want to just put this in your mind that there's somebody who loves you more than you could even measure. That when the Bible said this, it wasn't a cliche. That he said that God so loved, that means he loved the world so much that he gave his only begotten son. I don't know about you, but to give up my only son, the one of the kind, the only one of a kind that I had, to give him up for folks who I knew didn't really deserve it, that's love. That means he loves. There's somebody who loves you beyond your pain, loves you beyond your struggle, loves you beyond your faults, loves you beyond your shame, loves you beyond your guilt, loves you beyond your pain. Hallelujah. And he will not fail at his promise. So your heart doesn't have to be broken because there is a lover of your soul on this day. Hallelujah. And for those of you who've experienced love in this earthly realm in deep ways, I want you to just acknowledge and remember on today that it was only by the grace of the Almighty God. I feel like this. I ought to say this, that I need to tell somebody that, you know, the Lord has given you somebody to love. There are people who want somebody to love, but you got some foolishness going on right now because you don't want to show love to the one that God has given you to love. And so God is saying right now, stop the foolishness and get back to loving, because that's what God is all about. I'm going to be saying this a lot this month and in the month to come. As God gives grace, it's not about you, but it's all about love. And so we bless God for what he's allowed us to do in this place. Hallelujah. That we love him because what? He first loved us. And when we get the revelation of what kind of love, incredible love that is, you will, beyond a shadow of a doubt, be transformed. That your heart just can't be the same when you love deep like the Lord loves you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I want you to turn with me to the book of 2 Kings this morning. We've been talking about vision, and we're going to talk about vision for a couple weeks so that we can properly position ourselves to receive what the Lord has for us in the way of work for our hands to do this year. And God wants us to return to vision, but it's important that we understand. I don't like just kind of throwing words around. I don't like just moving words around just by happenstance and for pretense. Again, we remind you it's not about entertainment, but it's about edification. And the Lord has called his church back to return to vision, meaning to the original vision. The original vision that he had given the church in the book of Acts chapter 2 and Acts chapter 4. You read it because that's where the vision is. That's where God had already foresaw that his name, that his love, that his grace, that his mercy would be spread all around the world like he gave promise to Abraham in Genesis chapter 12. That we're a part of that experience, that we, as children of Abraham by faith in Jesus Christ, have a mandate and have a responsibility to spread this gospel all the way to the ends of the earth. What are you waiting for? What are you waiting for to tell somebody about the love of Jesus? What are you waiting for? I want you to turn with me to 2 Kings, the 6th chapter, number 6, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. The 6th chapter, and I have a story to read from you. There's a few verses here, and keep your Bible handy because we want you to be able to kind of elaborate with us through the scripture. But beginning in chapter 6, beginning at verse 8, I'm going to be reading from the contemporary version, Good News Version, but you follow along in whatever version that you do have. If you have the church app with you, I have loaded the good news version of these scriptures on that app as well. If you just go to our live stream, then you'll find it there. Amen. The notes. But we want to look at 2 Kings starting 6 and 8. It says, the king of Syria was at war with Israel. He consulted his officers and chose a place to set up his camp. But Elisha, that's the prophet Elisha sent word to the king of Israel, warning him not to go near that place because the Syrians were waiting in ambush there. So the king of Israel warned the people who lived in that place, and they were on guard. This happened several times. They warned them, and the people of Israel were on guard. And it happened several times. Which finds us in verse 11. It says, the Syrian king became greatly upset over this. He called his officers and asked them, which one of you is on the side of the king of Israel? Every time we set up an ambush, every time we try to take them out, every time we do something in secret, it seems they already know. Which one of you is on the side of the king of Israel? Verse 12, one of them answered, no one is, your majesty. The prophet Elisha tells the king of Israel what you say, even in the privacy of your own room. Oh, let me stop there while I read the scripture for just a moment. That he told him, he said, nobody's telling on you. It's that prophet Elisha. That the prophet Elisha, that he gets the news before even one of us gets the news. You all know how it is in Psalm 139, that God knows what you're thinking before you've even thought it. That God knows what you're going to say before you even open your mouth to utter it. God had given the prophet understanding. We're talking about vision. We're talking about things that are covered up. But if you look down the road, God is a down the road God, because he's able to see things that we're not able to see yet with the physical eye. He's already there when we get there. Oh, I don't want to preach just yet. I want to read this scripture. Look what he says. It's the prophet Elijah that tells Elisha, that tells the king of Israel what you even say in the privacy of your own room. King says in verse 13, find out where he is, the king ordered, and I will capture him. When he was told that Elisha was in Dotham, he sent a large force there with horses and chariots for the prophet Elisha. They were just coming after the prophet, but he sent a large force with horses and chariots. They reached the town at night and surrounded it. Early the next morning, Elisha's servant got up, went out of the house, and saw the Syrian troops with their horses and chariots surrounding the town. I wish we could get a picture of that. He went back to Elisha and exclaimed, "We are doomed, sir. What shall we do?" Look what Elisha says in verse 16. "Don't be afraid," Elisha answered. "We have more on our side than they have on theirs." Then he prayed, "Oh Lord, open his eyes and let him see." The Lord answered his prayer, and Elisha's servant looked up. Hallelujah. You remember we talked about that, where Abraham was told to look up. He looked up and saw the hillside covered with horses and chariots of fire all around Elisha. When the Syrians attacked, Elisha prayed, "Oh Lord, strike these men blind." The Lord answered his prayer and struck them blind. Just hold on, we're almost there. Then Elisha went to them and said, "You are on the wrong road. This is not the town you are looking for. Follow me and I will lead you to the man you are after." And he led them to Samaria. As soon as they had entered the city, Elisha prayed, "Open their eyes, Lord, and let them see." The Lord answered his prayer. Hallelujah. Oh, we could preach right there, but he restored their sight, and they saw that they were inside Samaria. When the king of Israel saw the Syrians, he asked Elisha, "Shall I kill them, sir? Shall I kill them?" No, he answered. Not even soldiers you had captured in combat would you put to death. Give them something to eat and drink and let them return to their king. So the king of Israel provided a great feast for them, and after they had eaten and drunk, he sent them back to the king of Syria. From then on, the Syrians stopped raiding the land of Israel. Hallelujah. What a story. It's one of the most treasured stories in Scripture, and it has so many different themes in it that you almost don't know where to start. It gives you such joy in your spirit to be able to understand that God was really saying some powerful things to Elisha and to his servants, that God was doing something magnificent in their lives. And we want to see that God is the same God who will do magnificent things in your life today. Amen. Elisha had a servant. Amen. You remember who Elisha was. Elisha was the trainee or the protege, or he was the student, the mentee of the great prophet Elijah, who God had used in powerful ways against Ahab and Jezebel, that he called down fire from heaven just to prove who the real God really was. Elisha had seen Elijah do so many magnificent things from the Lord. And you know how it is that when we walk with somebody who has great connection with God, that we find out that God is able to do great things in our life. Well, Elisha had a servant of his own. He had an attendant, and that attendant's name was Gehazi. We later learned that in Scripture, that Gehazi would watch over the affairs of Elisha. And Elisha had this thing going on that was reminiscent of Jesus when he was in the boat and the storm began to rage. And the disciples came to Jesus and said to him, "Master, don't you care that we perish? How could you sleep at such a time as this?" Well, Elisha ran back in the house after he had gotten up from his morning exposure to the world. He had seen the entire fortress surrounded by the Syrian army. And he ran back in the house and said, according to the account that we just read, he ran back in the house to tell Elisha, "We are in trouble. We are doomed. We're messed up, Elisha, because the entire Syrian army is on the outside. We're in trouble." Just like the disciples did when the storm began to rage on the Sea of Galilee with Jesus. And he said, "Master, wake up. We're in trouble. The storm is raging." He's saying there's troops everywhere, and we can't even number what we can't count them, how many are out there. They're surrounding us everywhere. We're doomed. We'll never get out of this one. And I believe that it is at that moment that Elisha began to do what Elijah used to do with Elisha, that he said, "Calm down, settle down." And I want to tell somebody, settle down. Settle down. God says, "You don't see things like I see things." And Elisha began to pray. He said, "Lord, it's time. It's time that you do for me what you did. Do for him what you did for me. There's a wisdom that I possess that my servant doesn't have, and he's in a panic situation. He doesn't understand the reality of spiritual things, and he's not understanding that we're not in this fight all by ourselves. We're not out here all alone. We're not in the place where we really think we are. In fact, it is not what it looks like. That there are things in life that we would go come up against us, and things in life and trials and tribulations and episodes and events in the circumstances of our lives that are going to look one way. But if God were to be able to give us his sight, that we would lose our panic." After he prayed, God opened up Gehazi, the servant's eyes, and he saw what was described as horses and chariots of fire all around Elisha. So yes, in fact, there was an army from Syria surrounding the place where Elisha and his servant were residing. But God said that you're not in this fight by yourself. And I want to tell somebody that you're not in this fight by yourself. when we get frenzied over our situations, when we get nervous about the details of what it looks like, God would say to us that I need you to stop and settle down for just a moment, because it's not what it looks like. That if you were to open your eyes and begin to see things the way that I see things, oh, somebody tell your friends, tell your neighbors, tell somebody around you that there's power in vision. There's power when you can see some stuff that your normal, regular, physical eye can't see. When you can see beyond a situation, when you can see your way out instead of being in the midst of what you're in, that when you can see the end of a thing instead of being in the midst of a thing, when you can begin to see what God is going to do because God has already done it. Oh, I don't want somebody to get panicked today, but I want you to understand that when you can look way down the line and see yourself delivered, that's what folk need to do, is begin to see yourself in a different predicament in the midst of your mess. You need to begin to praise God. In fact, we used to call it like this: praise your way out, because if you got the same sight as Jesus had, you could see yourself in a different place. That's what so many of us need to do. So many of us need to stop and really take a second look, because it's not what it really looks like. We need to take a second look and begin to see things the way that God has described some things for us. Gehazi was stunned by what he saw. He saw the armies of heaven surrounding the armies of Syria. And in that battle, he came to recognize that there was something bigger than his problem who had the solution to everything he needed. I want you to just take a look at this situation in this scripture for just a moment. What Elisha was trying to tell his beloved servant was something that we need to learn in the church today, is to recognize your resources. Number one, recognize your resources. That we failed to realize and failed to remember that we're not in a battle all by ourselves. We are not in situations on your job. You're not by yourself. You're an agent on assignment. That if God is sending you someplace, that's why you got to be connected with God. That's why you have to have your agenda be God's agenda. That's why you've got to recognize who you are instead of just who you are. You've got to recognize that if God puts you in a place, that God has already provided to keep you in that place. That we've got to understand that God does things in a bigger way than we just experience them in our simplicity. God wants us to understand that there's something bigger than you just going to a job every day, that you're not just your average every day. I don't know what your title is, and it might even be a high title, but God is not a respecter of persons. Titles don't mean anything to him. You're an agent on assignment for God to do his will and to do his bid. Hallelujah. On your job, in your community, in your church, in your neighborhood, in this world, everywhere that God will send you, he has already equipped you and he's already empowered you. And if we were to just open our eyes, if there was somebody who could pray for us, I'm going to pray for you today, just like Elisha prayed for Gehazi. I want to pray that God would open up your spiritual eyes so that you can begin to see things from a bigger perspective, because we walk around with too much fear and trepidation. We walk around thinking that we're actually the defeated instead of the victors. Hallelujah. We walk around like the enemy has programmed and wanted us to feel like that we don't have a hope, and there's no more dream left in us, and there's no more possibility. We walk around thinking that the enemy has really annihilated us and there's nothing left of us. But if God be God, hallelujah, he said, if I be for you, I'm more than the world who can come
come against you. God said, I sit high and look low, and that means that I'm higher than the enemy. In fact, if you read the first chapter of the book of Ephesians, that God would say that we sit with Jesus in high places, that we're not just down here in lowly places. Open your eyes and begin to see the bigger picture. It's not just about your physical walk, because there's more to you than your physical, that there's a spiritual part of you that sits high with Jesus. And when he's got his feet on the enemy's neck, that you've got your feet on the enemy's neck. It's all about your identity, remembering who you are and remembering whose you are because of what God said, not because of what you experience in life. Don't let your experiences define you. Don't let your experiences demoralize you, because God said, I've already destined you to a place on this earth. And if I'm going to destine you, I'm going to take you there. Let us go to the other side, is what he told the disciples when Jesus got in the boat and they began to panic. And he said, don't you know the storm is raging? But sometimes we got to know that in the midst of a raging storm, that God would say to us, just sit down and settle yourself down. All you got to do is stand up like this and say, peace, be still. And the waves had to stop their noise, and the water had to settle itself down, because God has authority over everything that you would ever experience. My God. He wanted Gehazi to just look up, hallelujah, and see the power that was around him. Have you looked lately to see what power lives around you? No, Pastor, I haven't looked lately to see what power exists around me. Well, maybe you ought to step up your worship. Hallelujah. Am I saying it right? You need to step up your worship, because God inhabits the praises of his people. Hallelujah. That means he comes in the midst of the praises of his people. That means when people start to praise him, that's when God shows up. Y'all hear me? I'm talking to my Levitical folk right now. When you start to praise him, it's not about entertainment. It's about when you start to praise him, that God comes down in the midst. It becomes like a channel. It becomes like a wave. It becomes like a cloud that draws down God into the situation. When you begin to beat on them drums, Brother Lamont, that God says, I'm coming. Here I am in the midst of what sounds like noise to some people, but is praise to my ears. When you begin to open your mouth and let your vocal cords vibrate, God says, I'm in the midst of that. And not just in the midst of that, but my power's in the midst of it. My healing virtue is in the midst of it. Oh, my, you know what? My sister told me a long time ago, I told her, I said, I don't like the way that I sing. I don't like to sing before people. She said, well, shut up that noise and just open your mouth and sing. It's not about you. It wasn't about you in the first place. So just maybe it'll bless somebody else. Just open your mouth and use what God has given you. Because when you open your mouth and use what God has given you, somebody else can get delivered. It's not about you. Open your mouth, play those keys, because when God slides down in the midst of us, in the midst of that key, those things just dancing off of the keyboard, God is saying that when I show up, my power shows up. When I show up, my grace shows up. When I show up, I bring my mercy with me. When I show up, there's an army surrounding. You may not see it with the naked eye, but I need you to look with the spiritual eye to be able to see that I come equipped for your challenge. I come equipped for your mess. I come with my miracle working power to be able to handle whatever it is that's troubling you. I need you to wake up today like Gehazi. Am I talking to you, Gehazi, or am I talking to you, Gehazi? Your tendency is to go out and get into a panic because you think that your enemy is much bigger than you. But if you just look, hallelujah, a little bit farther, if you just see, hallelujah, a little bit longer, if you just open up your eyes and remember what God said in this sixth chapter of 2 Kings, that you're not in the battle all by yourself. In fact, I did not even purpose for you to fight in this battle. I got you in your situation simply because I wanted to show forth my power and my glory. I just need you to stand up against the enemy and say, I'm not scared. I wonder if somebody will tell the enemy today, I'm not scared. I'm not running from this battle. I'm not going to let you push me aside. I'm going to stand up, hallelujah, and let the glory of the Lord fight my battles. Somebody out there needs a battle fought right now. You got a broken heart, hallelujah. You're living a broken life. You're living a broken situation. Y'all know what I'm talking about. You got them funny cigarettes in your mouth, hallelujah, that's destroying everything that God put in you. You got that mouth saying stuff, hallelujah, that will bring curse down on your life. You're laying in places that you got no business laying. You're not married to her and you're not married to him. And in fact, you're not even ordained to be married towards one another. God said you're doing some stuff that you got no business doing. You're serving some other God, and I need you to stop it right now. I'm your creator. I'm your redeemer. I'm your deliverer. I'm your way maker. I'm the company keeper. I'm the one who feeds you. I'm the one who keeps you. Y'all don't hear me in this house, that you can't just turn your back on me. You need me, in fact, because there is an army around you. But I don't want you giving Syrians the kind of respect that you are to give the armies of the heavens. Hallelujah. I got a Daniel, hallelujah, that can stand up in a lion's den. I've got a Jeremiah that can speak when he won't shut his mouth, when he wants to shut his mouth. I got a Moses across the sea when there was water more than he could see. I got a Jesus that got up from the grave according to the power of the Almighty Spirit. The same Spirit that raised him from the dead is the Spirit that will bring you back. Your mortal bodies will be quickened. And he said, so now today, I need to quicken your mind. It's not what it looks like. I need you to look beyond your trouble. Look beyond your struggle. Look beyond your situation. It's not what it seems. If you can just see like I can see. I'm talking about the power of vision, that if you can see down the road, you won't let the obstacles that's in front of you betray you, but deter you from your mission. Just walk through the valley of the shadow of death, because it's just a shadow. You don't have to fear any evil. I'm with you. My rod, my staff, I will keep you. My army, hallelujah, surrounds your every situation. Hallelujah. God said, the devil wants to keep you broken because God wants you to be a credible witness. But he doesn't want you to be able to witness. He wants to lie to you and tell you God is not able. But just like Elijah and all those prophets, those false prophets of Israel, stood up on Mount Carmel and they did their incantations and they made all kinds of noise and clangor and clamor. Just like they made all those noise in front of their leader, King Ahab, and his wicked wife Jezebel. They tried to show off their power, but it came to nothing to null. But then stood up Elijah, the prophet who called down fire to consume a pile of wood that had already been drenched in water. God is saying to you that if you trust me, I can do anything in your life. Stop limiting me by what you can only see, because it's what you can't see that's where the power really resides. Brothers and sisters, what am I asking you? I'm asking you to put, we're going to preach about this, walking by faith and not by sight, but I want to talk to you about this, that God says, don't just trust what your physical eyes can see. It's not what it looks like. I want you to get that on your lips, hallelujah, and tell your problem, hallelujah. Yeah, it may be rough, but you know what? It's not what it looks like. I need you to get a confession on your mouth and in your mind, hallelujah. My body might be aching, hallelujah, but I know a healer, so it's not what it looks like, hallelujah. We got to begin to give God the glory. God says he sent us out on assignment to win this entire world, and this is becoming a vicious world. But I want to tell you, I want to encourage you, it's not what it looks like. Some of you may be disappointed at the news you got on CNN or MSNBC last night, hallelujah, or on yesterday, and you're in a panic situation. But I want you to know, hallelujah, that even though there might be armies that might storm the Capitol, that they're nothing compared to the armies of heaven. I need you to understand that there might be trouble and tribulation surrounding your life and trying to squeeze the life out of you, trying to squeeze the breath out of you right now, that the enemy might be raising up on every corner and every place and every wise. He might be trying to put your fire out, but I need you to light your fire and let it stay lit right now, because if you can believe that God is the same yesterday, today, and forever, because the Bible says Jesus Christ the same yesterday, today, and forever, the same Jesus Christ, hallelujah, that was able in his power to surround that capital, that surround that place where Elisha was staying and his servant, that same Jesus that told Elisha to tell his servant to calm down. I tell you the same thing, calm down. Don't get yourself in a frenzy. Don't get yourself in a tizzy. I need you to get yourself stable and steady and let the Lord fight your battle. Hallelujah. That's all right. If you got to have surgery, go ahead and have the surgery, but walk on in with the power of the Lord, recognizing that, doc, you can do whatever you can do, but God gets the glory out of my body, because I know a healer who's bigger than my disease. I know somebody who's got more money than the bank can hold right now. It's not about what I got in my pocket. It's about who I am. And my Father owns the cattle on 1,000 hills. You need to begin to talk to your circumstance today and begin to say that, God, I trust you no matter what my circumstance, because I recognize that you said in your promise that you'll never leave me nor forsake me. So here I am. I stand up strong right now, recognizing that it's not what it looks like. And when the people of God get that confession on their lips, we're able to walk tall and walk in strength, walk with our heads up, and carry out the mission of the Almighty God, to do his work and his will. So whatever is troubling you today, I just came by to tell you this, that there's an army bigger than the one that's fighting you. There's an army bigger than the one that's set and positioned and in position to fight you. God says this, hallelujah. Recognize, hallelujah, that I'm your one. I'm your warrior. I'm your leader. I'm your battle axe. Glory. I am the one who's able to perfect everything that concerns you. I put out fires and I start a fire in the midst of a dry land. God wants to use you. And if you will just yield your life to him and say, come, Lord Jesus, have your way with me. I'm not going to worry about my struggle, because I know that you've already provided for me. God, so I want to pray for your people. Father, in the precious name of Jesus, I ask you, oh God, to open the eyes of your people. Every woman, every man, every little girl, every little boy, every old man, and every old woman and everyone in between. Even now, God, as they position themselves in the midst of what is a spiritual battle, just like Gehazi saw with his eyes, help them to know that there is a spiritual army. Open their eyes to see that there is help in every circumstance. Help them to know now, God, that you are with them. And when you say you're with them, God, we can recognize our resource right now. We can understand implicitly, Lord God, that your power prevails over every circumstance. And then help us, God, to recognize, Lord, that when we get that high horse on us that says, yeah, yeah, my daddy's there, he's there. And when we get that boldness to stand up, help us to stand up in that little thing you call, that big thing we call by this little word, love. No, don't kill them. Just lead them to the place where they can see how powerful your God really is. That even when you've captured another soldier, hallelujah, take him back to his king. Because we heard you in this story, Lord God, because Syria never bothered Israel again. Oh God, we look forward to that day when Syria will shut her weapons against Israel, and that your name may get the glory that only you are worthy of. Father, we bless you. Father, we praise you. I pray for every problem. I pray for every broken heart. I pray for every skeptic right now, Lord God. I pray for every circumstance. I pray for every situation, Lord God, that people didn't see coming. And it hit them just like it hit Gehazi when he saw a big army in front of him. Open their eyes to see the bigger army at work in their lives. Yet a little while, help us, Lord God, to stand with you and fight the good fight of faith unto victory. And we bless you, Lord God, for your might and your power. Now save souls, deliver, heal, set free. Make whole, God. Preserve until your coming again. That's our prayer. And we love you for it. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. If you've heard this word, if you've been a part of this worship today, if the Lord has touched you in any way, if the Lord has said something to you, if the Lord has moved in your heart in any way, we ask that you would just make this confession with us. Oh Lord, I recognize right now that I am a sinner. Hallelujah. I recognize, Lord God, that I failed you and that I have, Lord God, not seen you in all your power and all your glory. I have dumbed you down instead of exalted you up. I've spoken of you, Lord God, as common when you are sacred. And I've treated you less than what a king ought to be treated like. God, forgive me. God, hear this prayer. I want to turn. I want to move. I want to yield to your power. I want to yield to your majesty. I want to yield to your authority. And I want to do like those Christians say. I want to see you clean me up, God. Take the taste for bad stuff out of my mouth. Take, Lord God, the rejoicing for sin out of my heart. And move me along a path of righteousness. That, God, I might be a part of your end day glory. To shine for your majesty. If you can pray this prayer right now and say this, that, Lord, I believe, hallelujah, that you died on Calvary to take away my sins. And I believe on the third day you rose with all power in your hands. So, God, I thank you for the opportunity, because I call out your name to save me. And I receive your salvation. In Jesus' name, amen. If you prayed that prayer with me, then we ask that you would contact us, because we want to know all about it. Go on our website, go on our church app, and contact us and say, Pastor, I prayed that prayer. God made me new. We want to strengthen you. We want to send you something to help you along in your journey, so that you might be able to begin this walk in victory. And we speak over your trouble that its days are numbered, that your change is come. He's resident on board, because when you prayed, he snuck in to your spirit. You may not have felt him, but he's alive and well and moving and breathing even now in you. Contact us, and we'll contact you. We'll pray for you. If there's any with a prayer request, just pray. But send us a prayer request, and we'll pray with you that the Lord will deliver you from the hand of the enemy, because that's who he is and what he does. We thank you for joining us today. We thank you for being with us. We pray that the Lord has guided you and the Lord has directed you into deeper places of great joy. Happy Valentine's Day to you. God bless you. We love you. We say to you, worship our King. God bless you.
To know God is to love God, to know who he is for you, amen. So this song just lists everything that God is. He says, I am the creator, I am the maker of the universe. I am the one who spoke into nothing.
Hallelujah.
And all creation heard, I am he who has all power in my hands. And if there's a need, if you believe on my word, you can stand. 'Cause I am he. Mender of broken hearts, Alpha Omega, your destiny and where you start. I am the one who does impossible things. That's who I am.
That's who I am.
Just let me be who I am for you. Oh, that's who I am. Just let me be who I am for you. I am the one need and always provides. I am the one who names a strong tower where you can run and hide. I am he who has all power in my head. On.
does impossible things. That's who I am. Just let me be. Oh, that's who I am. Just let me be. Oh, that's who I am. Just let me be. Oh, that's who I am. Just let me be, Lord. Let me be your healer. Let me be your provider. Let me deliver you out of your circumstance and situation. That's who I am. Oh, just let me be. That's who I am. Oh, just let me be. Let me be your peace. Let me be your joy. Let me be your happiness. Let me heal you. Let me save you. Be that for you. Let me in. Let me save you. Let me heal you. Let me clean you up. Because I love you. Because I care. Oh, that's who I am. Just let me be who I am. For you.
Hallelujah. Glory be to God. Hallelujah. Women's Bake Off is Saturday, 10 to 12. Virtual Bake Off, go to our website. Saturday, 10 to 12. Men, Zoom meeting, Friday night, 7 p.m. Look out for the details. Visit our website. God bless you. We love you. Have a wonderful day. Worship our King.